Hi! I am fascinated by fluorescence and phosphorescence, like glow-in-the-dark items. Shine one color of light on them, and they emit another color. Especially the ultraviolet to visible light type is beautiful. Invisible light turned visible. But can I change the glowing color by changing what color and optical bandwidth I shine on glow-in-the-dark items? Or by a temperature shift? Time to find out. This will challenge my skills, or lack thereof, but let's explore it together. Avoid exposure to high amounts of ultraviolet radiation, and always wear suitable safety glasses when using strong lasers. As you may know, phosphorescent glow-in-the-dark chemicals are not exactly bright. A challenge for a spectrometer run by an amateur like me. So I will start by testing on something stronger and closely related. The fluorescent drink, tonic water. One of my favorites because it has bright fluorescence. Its blue glow reminds me of Cherenkov radiation, light's equivalent to the sonic boom. And it is easily available. Just grab it off the shelf at your local supermarket. How convenient is that? As a starting point, I will first measure its fluorescence when charged, excited, by a very intense amber searchlight. Its light is centered around 396 nanometers, but stretches from UVA to visible violet and indigo colored light. An optical spectral bandwidth of around 70 nanometers. Let's see how this light makes the quinine in tonic water fluoresce. Nice! Ignoring the small peak of reflected light from the flashlight, we can see the light from quinine fluorescence is a broad spectrum peaking in blue at around 460 nanometers. And it is a wide emission spectrum. A little hard to tell at the short end, where it is mixed with the excitation light, but looks like a bandwidth of roughly 260 nanometers. Almost four times wider than the light from the UV flashlight causing the fluorescence. Surprisingly wide, if you ask me. What will happen if I use an excitation light with an even narrower bandwidth? How about a violet laser emitting around 405 nanometers with a very narrow bandwidth of only 4 nanometers? Will this shrink the fluorescence spectrum? With laser safety glasses on and a home-built laser beam dump to safely terminate the high-powered laser beam, we will find out now. No, the fluorescence spectrum from the quinine is the same. It still peaks at around 460 nanometers and looks equally wide. Quite amazing, considering I am basically only feeding it one wavelength of significance, 405 nanometers. And that's even at the limit of what can excite quinine to fluorescence at all. It prefers to absorb, be excited, around 250 and 350 nanometers, so let's try a third light source. A disco blacklight. I had to tweak the spectrometer settings since the blacklight is much less intense than the two first ones. The fluorescence spectrum is overall similar, though it seems like the peak is perhaps 6 nanometers shorter. Did I just change the fluorescence slightly by using excitation light of shorter wavelengths? Or is something else up, like a temperature change? The tonic water was at room temperature in all tests, but the summer warm room probably heated up a little during the day. Let me try with the same tonic water cooled in my fridge vegetable drawer. It is now around 20 degrees C colder than before. Immediately, condensation formed on the cold bottle, giving me problems with a lot of reflected excitation light. After a bit of faffing about, I managed to record a fluorescence spectrum from cold quinine. Clearly, the fluorescence spectrum did not change center peak or width despite the temperature change. That's actually a thing. A fluorescence spectrum does not change with temperature, only the intensity. Should be more intense when colder, which I think the video recordings confirm, but not my haphazard handheld measurements. The slightly different spectrum with the blacklight is likely just an issue of low intensity, making it harder to tell the exact placement of the peak. Could also be Raman scattering bands from the water, adding to the spectrum and causing a slight shift in the total spectrum. Okay, the fluorescence spectrum appears independent of the excitation light I use. Changing color and bandwidth within the absorption spectrum of quinine simply doesn't matter. Does this apply to glow-in-the-dark items as well? Stay tuned, I will also attempt to shut down the fluorescence of quinine. Thanks to my awesome patrons for helping out with the expensive but well worth it spectrometer. I wouldn't have it without your support. For just a dollar a month, you can help me out too and get full access to all my posts on patreon.com. Link to my Patreon page in the description. Thank you. Phosphorescence has a much weaker emission than fluorescence, but by using this modern pigment based on strontium aluminate, I think I can capture it on the spectrometer. Strontium aluminate is in round numbers 10 times brighter and glows 10 times longer than the old zinc sulfide pigments. Here are the phosphorescence spectrums from the same pigments using the three different types of excitation lights. Will the spectrums look the same? They are the same. It is not possible to change the color of fluorescence or phosphorescence by just changing the exciting light. A bit disappointing, but I can't fool the electrons. Instead, I will tease them by shutting off their fluorescence. Whoops, I messed that up. Here is an improved setup, including a control glass. I'd say that stopped the electrons from fluorescing. Try guessing in the comments what I poured into the tonic water. I will reveal it and give a shout out to the best guesses in my next video. One final thing, as a thank you for watching this far. How can the fluorescence spectrum be this wide? Are the electron transitions not between a few fixed energy levels, like the thin spectral lines I can measure from mercury atoms in a mercury gas discharge lamp? Well, unlike the spectral lines, I am not measuring a single element or single atoms here. I am measuring molecules where atoms of several different elements are combined together with electron bonds. The electrons in a molecule like quinine can have a lot of different energy levels. Not only do we have the main electronic states, ground state and excited states. Each of these main levels have multiple vibrational sublevels from vibrations in the molecule. And each of the vibrational sublevels have multiple rotational sublevels from the molecule rotating. So the excited electrons in a fluorescent molecule like quinine can relax down into ground state level in a vast number of vibrational and rotational sublevels, giving off a wide spectrum of photon energies as electrons jump down into different sublevels. And since the emission of fluorescence in most fluorophores, including quinine, always happens from the electron at its lowest level in the first excited state, the shape of the emission spectrum is always the same, despite changing the wavelengths of the excitation light. Alright, I learned a lot about fluorescence spectroscopy from making this video. Click like if you did too, from watching it. Subscribe and ring the bell to make sure you are notified about my next video. In any case, thanks for watching. Bye for now.